I needed a photo of that. Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to just share some thoughts with you. Our governor just painted a very rosy picture of Minnesota. And while things look good on the surface, I just want to remind you what we are dealing with. Under a full Democrat control in the state of Minnesota in just 5 months, so looking back at last year, I want to remind everyone in Minnesota that $18 billion of surplus was spent. There were broken promises. Those dollars were not returned back to Minnesotans in a meaningful and tax relief way. We know that when there is tax relief offered for young families, families with small kids, as great as that sounds, and we are appreciative of that point, if Minnesota wasn't such an expensive place to live and to afford our lives, those things wouldn't be needed to the extent that they are truly needed. In addition to that $18 billion of surplus that is now gone, taxes and fees, our state budget was raised by another $10 billion. We grew government in a way that is unsustainable. You know that our economic forecast came out just a few weeks ago, and there was caution that was expressed by MMB, saying caution for legislators in any future spending decisions that are made. We are in a beautiful school that is part of a public-private partnership. We're in beautiful Owatonna, and we know that schools need to be a place that kids can have what they need, that they've got the education that they need. But under Governor Walz, as he took his position as governor in 2019, think of those kindergartners in September of 2019. Those kindergartners are now in their fourth grade year, but their testing as third graders in the MCA tests in the spring showed us that 53% of Minnesota kids across the state cannot read at grade level. That is under the watch of Governor Walz. So as we are doing great things for schools, we have to realize that every mandate that was just put on schools last year cost districts money. We want to do the right things for kids so they have the education that they need. But when those mandates came through to our school districts, unfunded, school districts across the state, superintendents across the state have concerns. They want literacy. They want to make sure kids have what they need. But the READ Act, or the science of reading, to make sure that literacy increases, is coming at a cost that is unsustainable going forward. You heard about historic investments in public safety. And that is great, but those dollars that were allocated to communities across the state last year came with a lot of things that money could not be spent on, specifically tactical vehicles needed by districts, or I'm sorry, by departments that were needed in public safety. They could not make any use of those dollars to improve any type of their public safety buildings, including lighting, sidewalks, just common sense things. There were a lot of strings attached to the dollars as they came forward. You heard that money was saved, or our seniors were now, you know, there was relief with Social Security. That is another broken promise. The tax on Social Security was means tested, and that was not fully repealed. Our seniors in the state of Minnesota are still paying tax on Social Security. And I want to talk on straw purchases. We know that safety in our communities matters. And you heard the talk, as the governor talked about, the tragedy in Burnsville. What we found out with that is those guns were available to someone that never should have had guns in their possession, but that was made available to that person by a straw purchase. In 2019, House Republicans authored a bill that would increase the penalty on straw purchases. We battled to get that done session after session. And I'm happy to report that the increase to a penalty for straw purchases was included in the public safety bill last year, passed by the House and the Senate. And then when it came right down to the conference committee, that disappeared. So as much as you hear our governor talking about wanting to increase that penalty on straw purchases, we agree with that. So last week on the House floor, House Republicans brought that bill forward, wanted to get the vote on the fact that we could increase the penalty and reduce the accessibility of guns by straw purchases, and that was voted down on party lines. There's much more that we can talk about. I'm going to turn it over to Senator Johnson, and then we would be very much open to questions going forward.
Well, thank you, Leader Damuth. Appreciate it. Senator Mark Johnson, Senate District 1, minority lead in the Senate. Tonight we heard a lot from the governor. I was happy to hear him focus on the future of Minnesota. That was really part of his message tonight, was the future of Minnesota. Unfortunately, last session, as Leader Damuth pointed out, we took some big steps backwards in this state. In some recent polling, you can see that Minnesotans overwhelmingly are saying that they don't feel as if they're better off in this generation as they were the last. And they don't believe that their kids' generation is going to be doing as well as they have. There's a real pessimism in this state, where you see education in steadily increasing in this state, and yet our schools are falling behind. You know, if we can loosen up some of the mandates for the funding, you know, where that money is going to be going, how schools can use it, let's give them the ability to do that, the flexibility to use those funds in their state. Businesses and entrepreneurs, they're feeling the weight of regulations and increased taxes on this state and what they're working on. Our border communities are struggling to keep businesses here in Minnesota. You know, you want to talk about law enforcement, being able to protect our streets, our people, our communities. They are facing huge challenges in how they can police our communities and keep our people safe. Then you look at some of the priorities that I think a lot of our residents are really expecting Minnesota to help to fulfill basic needs for them. Think about rural EMS. You expect an ambulance to come. If you make that 911 call, you expect somebody to be there. And yet the governor and the legislative leaders have set targets so low for these groups that I don't know how they survive. So these are some of the things that we have to face going forward. And I wish the governor would have addressed some of the plans that he had on how we're going to fix this state so that we have more optimism. We have a future in this state for not only our children, but also our businesses, our people just to be here, to stay in Minnesota. I think that hope is decimated. And we got to figure out ways to work hand in glove to get that back in Minnesota again. We need that hope here. With that, Representative Damuth, you did a great job on answering a lot of the questions there, but we still have opportunity here if you have more questions. Happy to take them.
Just going back to that, we were just talking about here, funding for that in this year's legislature. There's a bill out there for $120 million that targets 2016. Yeah. What is a happy meeting for that number? Obviously, Republicans have held that they want kind of a more conservative budget.
Sure.
There seems to be an appetite for funding there.
So the registered need, I think, is somewhere around $120 million is what's been stated so far. The problem that we're seeing with some of the current proposals is that you don't know exactly where that money is going to be funneled to quite yet, just because the formula isn't defined well. So we got to make sure that it's effectively spent, not just that we push out $120 million, but that we use it where there's high ROI within those agencies and communities that need that.
Any other questions?
I guess we haven't heard you on camera talk about the budget targets. I know you guys came out strongly against it, saying, you know, after record spending last year, another $450 million. What do you think is a number that is more reasonable for supplemental spending this year?
Here's what I'll say on that. I mean, there are some needs across the state that we're looking at. You know, we just talked about EMS as one of those needs that has to happen. But if we do not address the deficit, the structural deficit that we have in our budget right now, we are just taking money out of the savings account to make sure that we can pay our bills. So we need to be focusing on what our long-term budget is, and we need some solutions for that going forward. And we continue to see all this money being spent. That's going to catch up with us really quick if we empty out the savings account and we still have to pay those bills.
And I would just add to that that we haven't come up with an exact number, but again, looking at the needs that rural EMS or EMS overall is an area that we want to focus on. As we met with people and heard across the state, there's changes that need to be made there. We're willing to invest both for the short term and then changing that policy or what we need to look at to make improvements going forward later. We don't have a dollar, but again, taking that caution from MMB, saying that legislators need to be very judicious in the way things are spent, knowing that we have a looming deficit is something that we're definitely taking a look at and taking that into consideration. It's also a bonding year, we know that. Investing in roads, bridges, wastewater, those infrastructure needs, that is still being talked about. We are working through, the committees are doing their work through. I would say stay tuned for that. We know that's important across our state, that we're investing in a way that has meaningful investment statewide, not just locally focused in certain areas.
8 weeks to go. He was talking a lot about bipartisanship. Have you felt like there's been much bipartisanship in the legislative session thus far?
I am always hopeful that there will be, and we can improve on that. One area that I talked about earlier where we brought forward the bill for the straw purchases to increase that penalty, that was, to me, increasing that penalty should not be partisan. Unfortunately, that was voted down on party lines, and then without talking to the original author, there was a Democrat representative that brought that language in another bill at the committee hearing just last week, and when asked on record if she had worked with the original author that we had just a few days brought that forward, she said no. That shouldn't be partisan. I think there's ways we can find a way to work better together. That's what I'm hopeful for. House Republicans stand ready to do that. We've got to be able to be invited to the table and not have our ideas potentially co-opted in a way that they shouldn't be. Then I'll let you add to that. You know, what I would say is that they could be two separate issues. There was no reason to use an original bill as a vehicle. We have concerns with some of the other language that is included in there. If we could isolate that to just be the increase on penalties for straw purchases that we all agreed on last year, we would be very open to that. But taking it in and twisting it into something that would potentially jeopardize Republican votes is political games, and that's not what our state needs right now.
That's exactly it. Here we have a bill that we see there's a pathway for, that we see that there's a bipartisan appetite for, we think we can get done, and then they start throwing in other poison pills into that particular bill. I mean, this is something that's the safety of our communities. It's important to everybody. Let's figure out a way that we can get it done, and yet it's just games again. So.
Thank you.